Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Archform Beauty by L.E. Modesitt, Jr. Narrated by B.J. Harrison and Tina Wolstencroft. Great art is beauty. An elegant solution is beautiful as well. The beauty of words is lost behind the power of image. The beauty of politics lies in how effectively power is shared and transferred. A good family is a beautiful one. Chapter 1. Vienna, 1824. As the last notes of the orchestra fade into oblivion, the audience surges to its feet, the applause thundering across the hall. The tottering, wild-haired conductor remains facing the orchestra, as if afraid to turn, until the concertmaster, tears streaming down his cheeks, steps forward and takes the conductor's arm, guiding him to face the audience. The conductor finally smiles as he takes in the ovation he can see, but not hear. But the smile that crosses the creased and pallid face is part joy, part wonder, and part horror, that none recognize or sense but the conductor, who is also the composer. Both horror and wonder are lost in the applause that storms across the city, an applause that is darker than the night outside, an applause for music that casts a shadow far wider than any know, and for far more years than any could guess.
Chapter 2. Cornet. Since so looked at me over the music stand that she always set too high, every Tuesday, as if to erect a barrier between us. Her single suit had a pattern of angled stripes of cream and blue that made her look thinner than she already was. Her eyes were dark brown, like a cow's, almost ready to fill with the tears that her pride and family background wouldn't let her shed. After only a semester of teaching her, I was more than a little tired of her need to always save face. She shook her head slightly, and her bobbed black hair shivered. "Sinsel," I began slowly, standing up from the piano bench and moving away from the antique Steinway. "You have a good instrument, but singing is not just talent. If you want to be good, you have to practice more. You have to practice the way I've shown you." It was almost hopeless telling Sinsel that, but I had to try. "Professor Cornet, I do try. It's just not fun." She rushed on before I could say a word. "I used to look forward to singing at the academy. Now it's just work." "Anything you want to be good at takes work," I pointed out. "Singing's no different." She looked at me with that stubborn expression I'd come to know too well and said, "If singing isn't fun, maybe I shouldn't keep taking lessons. It's not as though I could really make a living at it." I made a living at it, and so did others. That kind of a living was a lot better than settling in as a corporate sorryman, no matter how high the pay and benefits were for multilateral servitude. "I do. But if that's the way you feel, maybe you shouldn't. You do res ads. That's not the same." "It is the same." I was trying hard to be patient when I really wanted to strangle her. "I couldn't get work if I couldn't do exactly what the studio wants vocally. I only get a few minutes to study the music before each session. You can't do that unless you understand music and your voice." When she didn't say anything, I added, "I also get gigs as a classical singer." Those were almost all art song recitals for one filch or another in Southside. Those recitals were a matter of prestige for the filch, because you can't res art song. But it paid, and paid well, if infrequently, and those were the nights I really enjoyed, because I could make beautiful music. I wasn't going to try to explain that. You can't explain beauty to people who don't feel it. My father says that old-style singing will be gone soon. People have been saying that for almost 3 centuries, ever since the electronic age began. Almost 3,000 years ago, Aristotle wanted to get rid of singers and poets. I smiled. We're still here. Still trying to bring beauty into a world that seemed to want less and less of it. You should talk to my father. That was the last thing I wanted to do. You need to decide what's best for your future, Sinsel. Your parents can't live your life for you. What do you want? I always thought I wanted to be a res pop singer, or maybe res rom. Do you like LMI? I asked. Most of the younger students soaked in and praised the romantic resonance slop that LMI put out. I had a hard time calling it singing. She's good. Sinsel was wary. That I could tell. She has the same kind of background I do. It's hard to get where she is without a good education and training. If you want to be that good, you need to practice. You need to practice the way I've shown you. I paused, then added, it's up to you. I kept my eyes fixed on her. She needed to know I was serious. After a moment, she looked down. I suppose I should practice more. If you don't, you won't have a chance to find out if that's what you want to do. She might nod anyway, but now wasn't the time to get into that. She had to get serious about something. My words brought the hint of a thoughtful expression, but all she said was, I'll see you next week. I looked at the back of the door after she left. Then I took a deep breath. I wondered why I bothered. I knew why. If I didn't, who would? Yet, did it matter whether classical singing remained alive in a culture where music had become ever more amplified, modified, synthesized, and simplified? Where it was on the brink of being able to mold emotions, whether or not the listener wanted to be molded? It mattered, I told myself, for about the 50th time since Monday. Then my internal links told me that I had 5 minutes to get to my class. I slipped on my blue jacket and picked up the data case in one hand and my notes in the other. I closed the door to my office, such as it was, and walked down the corridor. I kept a slight distance from the students as I slipped past the choral room where Jorge's modern choir was still practicing. Thankfully, when I went by, they were doing a Vaughan Williams piece, traditionally. I had to grit my teeth when they did Bach with resonance, and that was minimal res. But the audiences loved it. Tuesdays and Thursdays were my longest teaching days. Each had 2 student lessons and an hour and a half section of Music 101B, the Understanding and Appreciation of Music. I slowed behind 2 tall figures, listening. Nayad says she sings resads for her cake. Karima was going to take lessons from her till she found out she doesn't teach res stuff. Still not understanding why they make us take the course. Most of it's boring. No one listens to it, except the last week's. Actually talks about res music. Bet she doesn't know all that much. Karima said she does. I kept a smile to myself as I followed them into the lecture hall. I remembered Karima, a tallish Asian girl. She'd actually done well in the 101 class the semester before. As he took a seat in the lower tier, the dark-skinned and more angular student, Ibrahim Daoud, glanced back as he realized I might have heard his words. He smiled nervously. I returned the smile, then stepped behind the podium console. I laid my notes on the top, opened to the first page, and slipped the data block into the slot. If I'd wanted to, I could have programmed it to play from my office console, but that was wasted time, so far as I was concerned. The university didn't pay me enough for that extra time. I just stood there until quiet settled over the lecture hall. It didn't take long. The results of your tests are in your personnel files, in case you haven't checked. Most of you did well. A few of you still don't seem to understand that you need to study. I scanned the faces in the tiered seats of the hall. With more than 100 students there, I still didn't know all the faces. I shuddered to think what it would be like if I had the 200 the hall could hold. Do any of you have questions about the test? There weren't any, but there usually weren't. Those who had questions either saw me after class or asked them over the link. We're going to be hearing and seeing a symphony from one of the great composers who bridged the classic and romantic periods with his music. Just as Bach might be considered the father of the fugue, this composer might be considered the father of the modern symphony. The symphony we're going to hear is generally considered a classic symphony, although the third movement is scherzo form rather than minuet, and foreshadows the changes in the symphonies to come. I could tell I'd lost them and glanced around, picking a sleepy-looking face in the fourth row, one I knew. Duffied, do you know who the composer is?
Beethoven, he replied.
That's right. We'll hear parts of his Ninth Symphony next week, and you'll be able to hear the difference. Now, listen. The data block held videos of the New York Phil performing Beethoven's Fifth. Even though the hollow views alternated between players and pan shots of the entire orchestra, which just showed instrumentalists playing, I'd found that the students didn't listen as well or hear as much if I only played a straight audio. They had to watch something to get their ears working. Music by itself meant nothing to most of them. After the selection ended, I waited a moment before I began to speak. The first four notes of what you heard, da 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 da, in a way they were used as an early form of resonance music. Not when they were composed, but later. That got a few puzzled expressions. I waited before I asked, does anyone know when?
Weren't they some form of code in the First World War? At the beginning of the info rev?
Not exactly. They did have something to do with war and symbolism. Can anyone else tell me when and how? The vacant faces showed that they weren't about to provide an answer. During the Second World War, the British Broadcasting Corporation prefaced all its foreign language old-time radio broadcasts with those four notes as a symbol of victory. Those four notes also represent the letter V in Morse code, so that the physical impact, as well as the meaning, make the V for victory notes one of the first documented uses of resonance. A limited form, certainly, but so far, so good. No one had fallen asleep. Not yet, anyway. I hated to think about their reactions when I got to the later composers, like Bartók and the five-part Archform structure he'd invented and used for his concerto for orchestra. Next week, we'll get to another composer whose music was also used as the basis for early resonance motivation. For now, we'll look into the structure of the late classic symphony, the way it evolved from Mozart onward. I flipped my hair back from my face, and from there I went into examples of development with short excerpts from various works, mostly Mozart, since he was the most regular. All the time I kept thinking about Sinsel and her comments about making a living as a singer, because I hadn't been totally honest. She had been partly right about it, except for the handful of high opera singers kept by the old Met, the Kirov, and the Royal Opera, most of us had to use our abilities in a scattering of fields, from resads to the occasional art song gigs to teaching. And the teaching positions got fewer and fewer every year. I was lucky to have gotten even a solid adjunct position at UDenv, but it did allow me to keep singing and making beautiful music. I smiled and said, "The next excerpt is from Mozart's Hofner Symphony. He wrote this symphony in less than 2 weeks in 1782, yet some scholars think that it is technically one of his best. As I activated the data block, I couldn't help thinking that Mozart hadn't had it all that bad. He didn't have to have his compositions tweaked electronically for cheap emotional effects. Also, he'd only had to please one patron.
Chapter 3. Chang. I stepped into the department foyer off the underground garage. Like everything in DPS, the foyer was done in muted gray and forest green. Smelled like pine, roses, with an overtone of oil. I released the hold on the gatekeeper. Could feel the rush of data pouring into me, then the priority override.
Lieutenant Chang, Captain Cannizzaro wants you, soon as you're on duty.
Even on the link, I recognized Saro's voice and backlinked. On my way. I took the ramps briskly, didn't run. Stopped running through the department years ago. Didn't seem to matter. Street's the only place to run, and only there if you're frigged up bad. Never open your links to your work until you're there. You do, and you work all the time. Learned that one the hard way, a long time back. One day, linked into main ops and caught an all-purse alert. That was the beginning of the Tolaro trouble. Before I could unlink, Cannizzaro caught me on net, called me in. When I got back home a week later, Catalia was gone with the twins. Might have been better if I'd been like Ahmed. He spent a month in rehab. Family clustered all around, worrying. Me? I came home tired to empty rooms. Catalia had gone back to Portland, left a note. Said when I wanted to give up the department, she'd be there. VR'd her, and we had talked. She wouldn't budge. I don't like ultimatums, never did. Figured that if I gave in on that, I'd be giving in on anything. VR'd the twins every night till they grew up and went off on their own. Estefan's still in Portland, but Eric moved back to the East Coast. Still VR them, more like once a week now. Think they're beginning to understand, but you never know. After that, Cannizzaro insisted I go Trendside. She'd just made lieutenant, then insisted she needed someone like me. Guess she was right. I made sergeant along the way, then lieutenant 4 years ago, when she took over the department and I got her old job. Someone had to put the trends together. Study all the facets, try to figure out what was going to happen before it became too big. That lesson we learned from Tolaro. In Denv, that was me. Lieutenant Eugene Tang Chang. Official title was Trends Analysis Coordinator. Had just 6 people under me, but the job was a lieutenant's because the trends head had to have the street time and credibility. Need that. To brief the district coordinator and his staff, work with the soc-serv types, and hold the right kind of chill in dealing with the median netsies. Didn't take me long to get to the captain's office. It was on the 3rd level, overlooking the square, with the old state capitol to the east and the dozen remaining dinosaur towers to the west, all set in the middle of the park. Lots of trees and green grass. Grass was green, even in winter. I stepped into the office. Captain had done it in light blue, with darker blue trim. Very restful. She paid for it from her own pocket. Most of the other offices, mine included, were off-white. Close the door. Those were Cannizzaro's first words. I dropped into the ego chair at the corner of her desk console. Captains and lieutenants were the only ones who rated desks. Couldn't have been more than 6 in the building. Then, outside of the dispatchers, there weren't much more than 12 bodies there at most times. Patrollers and debts don't do much good if they're not out on the street. The net ops people were all in the annex, on the other side of the garage. I couldn't take that, patrolling the net for scams, larceny, and general misreps. Did it in training, long years back. Understood the need, but hated the job. Even hated analyzing their weekly reports. Didn't miss a word, though.
Couldn't afford to. I looked at the captain. She didn't look like a Cannizzaro, except in her eyes, a penetrating black. Thin, long face, squarish body, short blonde hair, worry lines running from the eyes that had seen too much. Chang. When she used my name like that, it wasn't good. Meant trouble in Denv. I waited. Your weekly report. That was all she needed to say. Something's going to happen, I shrugged. Can't say what. Start getting upticks in the little stuff. ODs, car delinks, TIDs. Always happens before something breaks. A lot of upticks. Too many for coincidence. District Coordinator Dewey is up for re-election. He's got an opponent with creds. Unlimited creds. Cannizzaro's voice was flat. Dewey had always supported the department, even when no one else had, even as far back as Tolaro. He's being opposed by Jared Allred, son of Aylwin Allred. The younger Allred claims the department lets matters get out of hand before acting. Old Broken Windows School. Can't tell you what's coming down, Captain, only that it is. As soon as you know, you'll know. I'd always let her know. First. I got a nod and a faint smile, as much as I ever got, before I stood. Even when I'm off, she added, use TP code. Stet, Captain. Then I headed down to my second floor corner office. Stopped outside in front of the consoles. Duty coordinator was Sorrow. Brunette. Intense. Her name sounded like Sorrow. It fit. Sometimes gave me grief. Practiced antique combat with sword and board. Married old style to a body sculptor, but refused to let him sculpt her. Good choice, I thought. Rishid's report is in your link file. She looked at me, but she was still monitoring the inlinks. Thanks. It always was. Rishid was indispensable. Then all of Trendside was. Thoughts? Like you said yesterday, something's coming down. Captain's worried. Sorrow nodded, her attention really on the feeds she was getting. Then she blinked and looked at me. Happy faces all over the place, at the pavilion, on the shuttles. Face scans show a good 10% increase in soup use, or something like it. More soup use meant that people weren't happy, turned to the designer exhilarant. But they couldn't stay souped forever. Lots of jobs required a nanite clean job before taking over a console or a system. Then most folks on soup were either students or servies, sometimes permies. Wondered at times if soup could make life better for a permie. Then, should it be? People didn't get permanent nanite behavior mods unless they'd been convicted of 2 violent offenses or 3 significant offenses. Any localization? Everywhere but Southside and the towers. Sorrow's voice was dry. We both laughed, hard laughs. Southside and the towers were gate private. Nothing happened there in public. Rumors about the filch orgies came up, but private was private, so long as no one got hurt. Wondered about that, too, after the Halbert clone scandal. How many others had been offed silently and replaced with more tractable clones? Had any? Who could tell? Trendside, you learn early that you don't guess. Not about the filch. Hard evidence, that's fine. But you don't fish there. Not without the captain's backing and full mil-spec nanite armor. I'll read it. I walked through the door. It opened to my aura, then closed. My office was small, a third the size of the captain's, just enough room for the desk and the console and 2 ergo chairs in front of the desk. Leaning forward, I could see sunlight glittering the gold-leaf dome of the antique state capitol. Back when a state meant something. Now it was a museum. Couldn't see the continental complex down south beyond Southside. Could almost feel it, though, at times. Called up Rashid's daily update. direct link to my implant. Didn't tell me that much. OD's up, nothing to flag any group, except age. All were under 25. Then more than 80% always were. A handful of vehicle delinks, including one electro lorry. The net tops reported a new scam targeted at the netless, offering them free access. Wasn't, of course. Area comms section had taken over on that. Data and more data. There's more to public safety than data. Data doesn't feel. Crime happens because people feel. You feel what they do, the data makes sense. I tried Net Prime News, the local reports. Best of the worst. Again, direct feed. Just closed my eyes and let the words and images appear. Didn't care much for hollow projections off the net. Crap blown larger remained crap. Most newsworthy item was a bit about the West Coast Whigs were modifying scanner glasses. Mods let the perps see who had nanite body shields. Make it easier to pick victims. Just what we needed. Another gadget to make public safety tougher. Wish someone had told the department. If the street hadn't been quiet, probably wouldn't have been on news at all. I flashed a memo to the captain, suggested it be disseminated department-wide. After that, checked all the incomings. Mostly routine. Only things new were a rash of phony soup sprays that were only glucose with a boost, and the theft of lorries for house smash-ins. Mass overwhelmed most house shields. Also a notice of higher DPS deductions for healthcare. That was because of improved internal nanite diagnostics. Took more equipment to read and repair. Higher healthcare, water surcharges. Not one thing, it was another. Almost 2 hours later, before I stretched and walked back out to the consoles. Going to run the towers, or west side? Asked Saro. West side. Can't get into anything in the towers. Not without appointments or a cause warrant. See me going to the regional advocate, asking for one just to prowl because I feel something's coming down? Too bad they don't let us do more of that. Never have, never will. How long? Saro looked at me. Long as it takes. I'll be on link if you need me. Didn't need to say that, but it made people happier to hear it. Even Saro, and she knew better. Ask why I go out? Why I don't link? People don't talk. They don't talk in person sometimes either. But the way they don't talk tells stories too. Went back down to the garage, to transport. Entered my codes through GIL link. Linking ID to gene codes, genetic identity link, made a lot of the old-style crimes almost impossible. Almost. Next came the code for recon. System paused, like always. Recon was a special code. Only Trendside could use it. I got a white electrol. Nothing special except a beefed-up comm unit and military-level def screens. Electrol was recoded just for me by the time I crossed the garage. Door still squeaked. Always would. Smelled like plastics inside. That wouldn't change. Touched my hands to the stick wheel. Cleared for recon. Estimate return. 1400, I always spoke, but linked when I said it. The gates irised wide, took the west tube, and came out beyond the park and towers. West side's on the other side of the river, if you can call the Platte a river. The Metroplex quarters fan out from the park. North side's production. East side's transport and Saruman housing. South side is Filch, Wish Filch, and Upper Saruman. Then there's West side. Trades. Surveys on the way up, surveys on the way down, and a scattering of netless blocks. The Downs. DPS links worked there, but not much else. Could have taken the express tube, but you don't learn much underground. Instead, I went over the Elitch Bridge. Saw all the surveys in their old scooters, or on the shuttle glideway, headed to south side or north side. On the bridge, I turned north on the Bryant Guideway, then west past the West Side Fields. First stop was Morse's Galleria. Fancy name for an old-style pool joint with a couple of formulators that served food at four times the cost of home units. Mornings were slow. Only a side table was used. Two old servies. They leaned on their cues as much as used them. Both watched when I walked in. Was wearing a dark blue single suit, Sariman business style. They still watched. Morse moved to me quickly, then stopped. It was looking to be a beautiful day. Been a while, Lieutenant. Morse always said that. Could have been talking to him the day before. Still tell me it had been a while. Little stuff. Lots of it. Didn't look at him exactly. Not with the scar running from the corner of his mouth to his ear. Just waited. My eyes mostly on the street. You always had a sense about that. Remember the time you walked to John's, then walked away? You couldn't have been 10. Chu and his boys going over John. John didn't forget. Sure didn't. Morse shook his head. Today, this week, nothing I know about. He frowned. It was Luke's kid, Al. Disconnected the overrides and safeties on his dad's lorry. Ran it off the guideways and into Clear Creek. Didn't sound like what I needed. Know why? No one does. He didn't tell no one, not even his girl. She'd been crying nonstop, they say. Young Al, he was a quiet kid, mostly. Been to Flame Top concert last night. Found him early this morning. Luke was real broke up. His boy was a good kid. Sorry for them both. And the girl. You might know her, Lieutenant. Tasha Lee. Zhu Li's daughter? His youngest. Zhu wasn't too happy about the two of them. Never said much, but I could tell. You think it was a screen? Morse shook his head. Nah. Zhu figured it wouldn't last. Al never stayed with a girl more than a few months. Made a mental note to my link file to check out the accident. Anything else? Remember old Arturo Kemmel? Went with his daughter once. Say he's about to die. Hanging on for now. Only 90. Drank too much. Nanites can't beat that. And last week, maybe the week before, his grandniece Antonia died. Rock climbing up north somewhere. Old Arturo was all broke up. He does love his family. That was about all I could say for him. Hasn't Chris been running the outfit anyway? As for years, you're not his favorite, Lieutenant. I laughed. Never was. Not after his sister. He still got Grazer on the heavy equipment? Far as I know. Morse stopped. Boys tell me Chris is working to make it all legit. Put stuff in place once he takes over official-like. He claims he owes it to his kids. Got a lot of creds from someplace. All legal, Bolser says. Chris has some idea about spinning the heavy stuff off to someone no one heard of. Guy's an ex-Whig that came out of the L.A. desert. I laughed. Kemmel going legit? Even with their big company and all their credits, the family couldn't walk straight with a laser guide. Been true of Kryn, too. We talked for another half hour. Didn't offer me any more insights. When I left, the ex-servies stopped their game and watched. So did Morse. He was still watching when I eased the electrical back toward Bryant. Second stop was West Side Physical Systems, only about a click southwest of Morse's place. Small office building with a formulation shop behind it. No other electrals around. So I parked right in front of the door. Like all DPS electrals, the white one self-locked the moment I stepped away. Inside there was a foyer, a counter, and a permie at a console behind the counter. Walls, floor tiles, countertop, all were maroon, all spotless. The permie looked up from the console. Yes, sir? Lieutenant Chang, Department of Public Safety, here to see Kama. His full name was Kamehameha O'Doul. I'd never used it. Hadn't asked how the Hawaiian in his past met the Irish in Noram, either. Kama was more than 2 meters tall and well over 120 kilos.
I'll tell him, sir.
The survey went link, his eyes blank. Then he said,
He'll be right here, sir.
Kama slipped out of the back room. Hard to believe he was so big. No fat, and he moved like a dancer. He wore a spotless white coverall. The shiny boots were black.
Trouble, I see.
Kama grinned. I grinned back, then shrugged helplessly.
How's business? Fine. People still need plumbing and pipes along with their nanite-based house systems. You're lucky you caught me in.
The grin vanished.
You still owe me a game of chess.
Owed him that game of chess for more than 20 years. I know. You'd beat me. You always did.
That's not the point. It's a game of beauty.
If you say so. I wasn't sure that was the point. If we both linked, usually got a draw, based on old Grandmaster games. If not, Kama won in 20 moves, maybe 30. That was beauty? Just asking. Got a feeling something might be happening. The contractor's eyes narrowed.
I've never liked your feelings, Eugene. Is it anything I should worry about?
I shrugged. Couldn't say. That's why it's a feeling. Minor offenses up. Poles worried. No one says much.
You could be wrong.
Been wrong before. Be happy if I am. Anyone building a fortress?
I wish someone would. Business is a little slow, except repairs here in Westside.
He laughed.
Something always goes wrong here. You have to make dozens of little service calls to make ends meet.
Too bad you can't do service Southside.
Most of the Filch mansions have self-repair systems. Here, who can afford them? Only business I get there is either new systems, total disasters, or upgrading whole systems.
Get any of that?
Maybe one every other week, about the same as always.
Each one more elaborate?
Why else would they upgrade?
Kama smiled more broadly. So it would take a cargo lorry, loaded with lead at full velocity, to break into one of those Filch palaces?
For most, some would take more. One place has a fuel cell power room that would run half of Westside.
That has to be Alumbart.
You can guess all you want, Eugene.
What about the McCall thing? That your system? Pretty horrible. Kama shook his head.
Brazelton's. He's 100 times our size. He's got system techs. They do it by the link manual. I do all that myself. I couldn't afford a tech.
Bet your system designs are better. Kama smiled.
Probably. But from what I can tell, it wouldn't matter. McCall re-engineered it. That's what your DPS techies claim.
What do you think? Kama frowned. I waited.
McCall is a solicitor. What solicitor knows nanite systems that well?
I nodded. He used to work for O'Bannon and Reyes. O'Bannon was pretty close to Chris Kemmel.
Do you know something?
Kama raised his eyebrows. With privacy laws, who could know? I offered a grin. Chris Kemmel. Heard anything?
We're not exactly friends. His circle is higher than mine, Eugene. It's much higher. You've been closer to him than I have.
I waited.
I haven't heard anything. They say Kemmel's hurting. Dewey doesn't like him, and neither does Senator Cannon. Kemmel's been seen with Heber Smith lately.
Heber Smith? I hadn't heard that name.
He's the campaign manager for Allred. They don't call him that. He says he's a business consultant, but it's no secret that Allred's going to take on Dewey in the summer election. Allred's also backing Hansen against Cannon in the fall.
Because Cannon mandated the guideway study and the changes in the maintenance requirements?
Something like that,
Kama said. Kemmel wants the guideway repair business back.
He never had it. Brazelton did.
I snorted. Brazelton had the business before it went to GSY. Creds behind it were Kemmel's. He wants a return on those creds.
I'd guess so.
Wouldn't you?
I'd have guessed a lot more. So would Kama.
Heard Arturo's hanging on. Might die.
He already died where it counts a long time ago.
I sighed, loudly. I may be back.
You're worried.
Goes with the job.
Remember, you owe me that chess game.
How could I forget? How could I? Owed him since before I'd gone to the DPS Academy.
Kama never forgot anything. Never would.
Might not tell, but wouldn't forget. I walked out to the electrical, standing by itself out front. Kama watched me from the door. Sometimes I felt that everyone watched me. I'd barely pulled away when Sorrow linked me.
Lieutenant, Captain wants to know if you found anything.
Nothing. Might help if I knew what I was looking for.
She asked to be linked if you came up with anything.
I'll do it. That was the way it went all day. Knew I was on the edge of something. Just didn't know what. Couldn't even figure out where to ask, or what. Got back to the garage at 1440. Took a few minutes to satisfy the transport system. Needed a statement if I was back more than 15 minutes past the estimate. Stopped by the captain's office before going to mine. She looked worried. Worried and tired.
You didn't find anything, did you?
Nope, I admitted. Something's coming. Street's too quiet. Too normal.
Not all the problems are on the street.
Kanazawa leaned back in her ergo chair and smiled faintly.
They never have been.
No. But the slick problems cause street problems, and big slick problems cause big street problems.
You think it's a slick problem or a filch one?
I don't know. Let me work on it.
You're the last of the street cops, Chang. After you, things will change.
Shook my head. Always be street cops, Captain. Just fewer. Two kinds of perps. The Saruman and Filch slicks, and the twisted servies. Need people who know both. I knew servies and permies, and the netless. Didn't know the slicks. They were for the net ops types. Even as I thought that, knew I'd have to look deeper into the net ops reports.
Let me know.
That was all the captain said. Soon as I do. I walked out of her office and down the ramp to mine. Sorrow raised both eyebrows when I neared the consoles. Just more feelings. Need to look into some things.
Anything I can check on? Screens are slow now.
Not yet. Don't know where to point you.
Whenever.
I smiled. Back in my corner office, I called up lorry accidents. Three flashed into my mental screen. Second one was in Clear Creek. Medical had added info since the morning. Young Al had been drinking. Alky levels just below impairment. No other drugs. Baseline nanite body protectors way down. No infection, and no sign of past injury before the crash. Probably Luke had been short of creds, put off his son's annual med check. Bad idea, but hadn't killed Al. Crash had. Still bothered me. Couldn't say why. But had more incomings to check on, and my own report to the captain. No hurry to get home. Nothing to get home for. Linked to the system again. Could always check on Heber Smith and some of Kamal's other associates. Maybe some tie with McCall. Maybe there was something, somewhere, that would tell me my feelings were right.
Chapter 4, Munich, 1941. Torches blaze around the rear of the hall, lighting the red, black, and white banners topped with bronze standards.
Wie zuerst ich dich fand als feurige Glut, wie dann einst du mir schwandest als schweifende Lohe, wie ich dich band, bann ich dich heut.
The masked voices blend into an echo that reverberates up into the darkness of the Kongresshaal. The outspread arms of the copper eagle stretch above the hooked cross and the brass bowl
where red flames lick at the gathering darkness. The lower notes echo from the pipe organ, the tones resonating through the vast hall under the Deutsches Museum, rippling the crimson banners that seem to drip blood upon the black-clad honor guard below. Wie ich dich band, bann ich dich heut. As the music fades, indrawn breaths punctuate the silence of the dark. Presently the words begin, almost as if a continuation of the Wagnerian resonances. A heritage beyond price, an honor beyond honor, those who gave their souls for the freedom and future of our people and for the eternal greatness of the greater German Reich. Germany, Sieg Heil! Sieg Heil! Sieg Heil! Sieg Heil! The refrain echoes like thunder into the upper reaches of the Kongresshaal, shaking the Deutsches Museum from beneath, shaking the ground around and rippling into the darkness far beyond Munich.
Chapter 5. Parsfall. I was buried in the southwest corner of the lowest level of the university library. My eyes burned as I flicked past image after image in the reader, hurrying through decades of information quickly, trying to locate old photos and stories not in the link archives, or even fragments of stories that could be twisted as needed. I already had some possibles that I'd scanned into my office archives, two about Walter Cheeseman, one about Moffat, and a couple about Territorial Governor John Evans, and some from later governors of the former state of Colorado. I got tied up with some articles about a political organizer named Robert E. Lee, who was sometimes called the General, but who wasn't one. That was the trouble with liking your work, besides being single, that is. I had to fight to stay on the subject at hand. Net Prime wasn't paying me for psych spinning or straight historical research, but for usable slants for Prime News.
Parsfall, where are you?
I winced at the volume on the link. Bimstein always overboosted. In an earlier age, he would have yelled, like Yeats's rough beast slouching toward Bethlehem, except Yeats never envisioned his beast yelling as the center fell apart. And Bimstein wouldn't have understood a gong-tormented sea, or even a wine-dark one. He would have made some caustic remark and told me to get back to work. Where I said I'd be, in the old university library, you wanted background on the southern water diversion.
Why did you have to go there?
Because the old newspaper stories were microfilmed or fished or whatever, and it would have cost too much to convert them to electronic storage, so no one did.
What will that give us?
The same as always. The impression that we look into things much deeper, that we, above all other newsies, understand the depth of the stories we cover and provide a beauty of coverage that no others can emulate. I paused. While providing color and other titillations from those safely dead and beyond the shelter of the libel laws. I could sense Bimstein's snort over the link.
Don't be too long. Kerris says he's going to need your touch on something else. It must be big. He won't say what.
Kerris never said what he was working on, not unless Kuntz landed all over him. But whatever he was working on was big, whether it was a 3-cred miscredit in the local housing assistance office, or a rash of deductions of invisibles, or a massive kickback from the Martian Republic to MM Systems for leaking the design of the latest asteroid tug's debris screens. It hadn't been called a kickback, of course. The Republic had just paid what it called an early delivery fee for some standard power modules. With Kerris, the current story was always big, and he was always upset if he didn't get the big ones, like the PDF asteroid stories that Kuntz had given Brianne DeVoe 2 years ago, after the Belters had miscalculated and sent all sorts of rock heading earthward. Water asteroids were easy to destroy or divert compared to mining debris. And Kerris had wanted that one, but Kerris hated all Belters and didn't care that much more for the Martian Republic.
Parsfall,
Just finishing up. Be back in less than an hour. Bimstein didn't answer, and I just got his simmy. So I broke off even before the simmy could offer to take a message. The regional water diversion was coming up before the NORAM Senate, and the debate would be heated because of the continuing drought and the low flows in both the Rio Grande and the Colorado. Fenix had put population caps in place and wanted Denv to do the same, or send more water south. I was already getting big play in the Denv district coordinator's election, and I wanted some deep background quotes, historical quotes, or statements that sounded real and that no one could dispute. Then who was going to dispute pre-collapse quotes anyway? Karras needed stuff that would show the issue was more than words, that it went back a long time. What I was doing would take more work once I got back to the office, because I'd have to refine the personae that resembled the historical figures, and then spend an extra hour, or more, getting the details right. But it worked. The segments for which I'd done the research and creative recreations had the highest ratings of any local news provider. They always did. I shut down the reader and closed my portable scanner, then walked over to the records custodian. The permie, who'd been watching me for almost 2 hours, since there was no one else down in the archives. I extended the case that held the old records. Thank you. Glad to be of service, sir. His face wasn't quite blank, but he wasn't smiling either. With a nod at the poor man, even if he had deserved permanent nanite reprogramming and was bound to tell the truth at all times, I took the ancient circular steel stairs that must have been 200 years old and hurried up to the main level and then out into an overcast late March day that was as cold as early February, without the snow. A day that all the instruments would agree was a dark, cold day, even if it weren't in January. I'd debated calling an electrocab, but Bimstein wouldn't have allowed it as an expense, and I didn't want to eat that fare. Instead, I walked across the gardens east of the library and then south along the ancient boulevard, hurrying most of the way, until I reached the local shuttle station. There were a good 15 people waiting already, and that meant a shuttle was likely to be arriving soon. I could have linked and called up a schedule, but what good would that have done? The shuttle wouldn't arrive any sooner. Most of those on the platform were students. They were the ones in multicolored single suits, without jackets or with sleeveless vests, or occasionally with a jacket but one left open. They clustered mostly in groups, looking as though they didn't want to be there, as if taking a shuttle were somehow beneath them. Then there were the junior faculty types, looking not all that much older than the older students. But then with nanomeds, no one looked much older than grad students, except in the eyes, until the last decade of life, when even nanomeds didn't help. The faculty types wore either solid-colored single suits with jackets over them, or tunics and trousers and jackets. I usually wore a single suit with a jacket over it, but that was more for convenience, with the moving around that could come at any time in digging up stuff for Net Prime. The tunic, trousers, and jacket were what I preferred, but I never got to wear them enough. Once on the shuttle, I listened. It was useful and sometimes interesting.
Sometimes, rather be an invisible.
Nah, they got caught.
Dagmar got accepted by A-Square for pilot training.
Wouldn't catch me driving a steel closet through the belt.
Lots of creds.
See those meteors last night?
Ice chunks, sloppy mining. Claim that Elmai and Aristo are clones, link programmed to sing. Eyes don't look that way. Cleanup programming, take care of that. Think about that Filch McCall? Did it, if you ask me. I got off at the old tech station on the low ridge that split the true Filch part of Southside from the part where the less affluent Filch and High Saruman types lived. I couldn't see that much difference, especially not compared to my tiny quarters. At least I had a standalone house in the small historic district, even if the walls did date back more than 3 centuries, and the covenants required that I not change the exterior. It was the only thing I'd gotten from my grandmother, worth about half a small filch mansion. But you couldn't buy half of one, and I couldn't afford the other half. Damned if I would live in East Side or East South Side with the Saruman types either. I suppose that made me a snob of sorts. The old tech station wasn't much more than an antique brick platform, with a slate tile roof and nanotech screens to break the wind. Only two of us got off. The other was a woman, in the single suit of a comm inspector. I just hoped she wasn't headed for Net Prime, but she walked eastward. Could be headed for either Nornet or one of the Indies. The wind had turned warm by the time I left the station, a spring Chinook that appeared from nowhere and had me opening my jacket before I'd walked 100 meters. Another 200 brought me to Net Prime, a low, pale green marble structure with clean lines that rose out of grass that was green even under the snow in full winter. The building was nestled into the ridge, with 4 levels below ground and 3 above, meeting the environmental requirements for non-obtrusiveness. The tech areas were mainly on the 3rd and 4th levels down, but I was lucky. Issues research was semi-tech, and that put me on the 1st level down and off the main garden courtyard. So I had natural light through the courtyard skylight. What I didn't have was much space. My cube was all of 2.5 meters square, and most of it was taken up with shelves, filled either with data blocks or several dozen hard copy, old-style books that had never been converted to electronic storage. Not that I'd been able to find. One was a gem. Statistics from colonial times to the present. Of course, the present had been almost 200 years before, but the numbers were fascinating. More than 300 million people just in the old USA section of NORAM? Unbelievable. I had barely passed through the archway that held the concealed security scanners when my link buzzed. Parsfall, you back yet? Karras came across the links as thin and whiny, for all that his voice was mellifluous in person and over the net. Mellifluous. Beautiful word, even if I did have to keep it for myself. Just heading down to my place. Got a couple of sweet hist lots for the diversion piece. You'll love them.
I might. How long?
How much time do I have?
Nor News doesn't run national for almost another hour. Need to jump them. Bimstein says you've got 30, pushing it.
You'll have something.
Thanks.
How good it would be was another question. I'd hoped for an hour, although I'd already linked the scans of the old photos I'd taken in the university library to the SIMI-building program with commands to construct, but the tweaking required to make the images look real on a holo projection could take the hours I didn't have. Hurrying down the ramps, I barely avoided ramming into Eldigo, the ROM News anchor. His late-afternoon slot had a 9% share of the total sectoral news market, close to phenomenal in a fragmented full-net system where a 2% share for a single slot was considered respectable. Eldigo smiled, and I grinned back sheepishly. The man never seemed upset.
Parsfall?
Karras again. I'm working on it. That was almost accurate, even if I weren't quite to my cube.
We've got some advanced stuff on the McCall murder.
Murder? Thought she was trapped in her electrol when it caught fire and the nanite system expanded to contain the blaze. Programmed wrong.
/Burn News already out with a story that the regional advocate's office is going to indict, claim that her husband reprogrammed the system against her electrol. So we're behind. Need an angle. When you get the hist slots done, need background on him and on elaborate murders of the filch, you know.
I know. Later. Or you won't get these. He was gone, and I was brushing past Estancia as she left her cube and I slipped into mine, linking into the system, to check how the constructor had rebuilt the SIMI of the long-departed Colorado State Governor Evans. The problem was that there weren't many photos from when he'd been governor, and most were from his later years. So I needed some regression there, trimming and darkening the beard, adjusting the skin tone and tension. A lot to do in not that much time. Before I knew it, the link was buzzing again.
Only got 10 minutes for the hour top slot.
Done. Feeding to Matesta now. Bimstein got on my nerves, but there wasn't any help for it. He might lizard me endlessly, but he let me work my own way.
Thanks. Try not to push it so close. Sometime this afternoon, in between, while you're looking into the McCall stuff, also need a few facts on the legislature's funding for local education and something on the nanomed support level for immigrants.
We try, but digging up the old stuff and verifying the new takes time. Again, he was gone, and I had to cut off his simmy. He was like that. Before I went to work on the McCall murder stuff, I wanted to see how much Matesta used in the final cut for Karis's water piece. I called up the running cut for the news, watching on the screen, rather than having the hollow field fill my cube. The first image and voiceover I got was an image of a starburst, followed by an intense point of light, and trails of light flying in all directions before fading.
That was the PDF successfully destroying an errant water asteroid headed toward Earth. We'll be back in a moment with the details.
I skipped ahead to Karis's piece, which ran later in the national news roundup.
Here with Senator Cannon just outside the Senate chambers is Les Karis.
The field cut to the tall senator with the deep blue eyes and striking white blonde hair. Cannon offered the viewers an engaging and warm smile, projecting a palpable warmth and concern.
Senator Cannon, you've opposed the Southern diversion ever since you were first elected to the Continental Senate. Why?
The Southern diversion is nothing more than filch food. Filch food for the Southwest. East Slope needs its water. Formulators don't make water. Every liter that goes south raises the cost for the people of Deseret that I represent. It's that simple. Diversion means higher prices. Diversion's theft with fancy words.
A wider smile followed.
It's also theft from the people of Denv. Theft that could lead to population caps here.
I had to smile. Every sentence was short, and there were plenty of 5-second cuts for the insta-news types. No one was going to out-simplify Cannon, and he'd also placed himself in favor of protecting both the people of the Noram capital and his own district. He didn't miss many angles. Karis voiced over.
That was Senator Cannon about water diversion. Diversion fights go back a long way. Back to the first territorial governors. Here's what they had to say.
The simi of Governor John Evans was almost perfect, with the well-trimmed dark beard, the vest, and the wide lapels of the frock coat, and the deep, resonant voice.
Besides the Denver Pacific Railroad, the Denver Union Water Company was what made Denver into the state capital and the only tolerable place in the western wilderness. Take away the water, and you would have nothing but the savages of Sand Creek.
Then came the simi of Governor John Vanderhoof.
I stand on the principle that you shouldn't build dams that take water and provide nothing in return. Diversion is theft, nothing more.
I was pleased with the hard-eyed look that I'd managed to inject into that simi. Of course, they hadn't quite said what I'd had them say, but it was close enough, and certainly accurate in an overall historic sense. Kara's voiceover continued.
There you have it. For over 300 years, the people of Denv have had to fight for their water. Senators Eldon Cannon and Christine Patroclus are carrying on that fight against the filch interests of the Southwest. Karis had provided the senator with coverage almost as good as a res ad, one of the new ones, for free. And I'd helped, as usual, even if I didn't care much for Cannon. Then I didn't care much for politicians of any kind. Patroclus was a pleasant cipher, and that was why Karis had used Cannon. I couldn't rest on self-satisfaction, though. I had to get back to digging up numbers and examples for Karis that would fit the McCall case. After all, Prime News was news with a difference. The difference being the slight gloss we added with hist slots and numbers, or with any other slant we could find. And it was my job to find the slant.
After wandering out to the break room and getting a beaker of orange juice from the formulator, charged to my account, of course, I went back to my cube to start on the background to the McCall murder case. My first cut at statistics didn't do much good. As I'd suspected, while there were NORAM enumeration blocks that were categorized by income levels, the blocks were regular squares and didn't fit the actual Denv quadrants. Nor did the overall stats help much. Less than 2% of NORAM population was filch, but the filch weren't distributed equally. Most were in centers. Probably 10% of the Denv area population was filch, or in secluded locales where they had private retreats. Springs was about average, while places like Pueblo and Collins had nearly no filch. Durango and Aspen were each nearly 70% filch, and had been for centuries. But two areas of less than 1,000 people didn't affect the area percentages much. I tried an overlay of filch housing patterns on the census blocks, and geographically, it came out that 60% of the land in Southside was filch estates. But Southside as a whole, even with the near filch and the high Saruman, only held about 10% of the Denv area population. That was rough, very rough. And if I came too close, then the district advocate might come down on Prime News for primacy violations. There might be a way, but that would take time, which was short. I ran a full archive search, both of the news-to-print files and the Holocaust files, just using the terms filch and murder. Less than 50 matches in the past 10 years. That seemed odd, far too low. So I expanded the time frame to 50 years. That showed up with 270, also seeming low, but enough to work with for refined scans. I definitely had some work ahead of me. I also had to dig up some of the education and immigrant support figures, if I could find them. Then I had to offer the Prime News slant.
Chapter 6. Cannon.
Good morning, Chairman Cannon.
Halberstam greeted me as I walked up to the GIL verifier at the members' door to the Economics and Commerce Committee hearing chamber. Good morning. I offered a smile. How's Andrea? Andrea was his daughter. She'd just gotten her law degree and certification as a solicitor in the Deseret District Bar. Lovely girl, and bright. Too bad she hadn't found the right man yet, but she had time. The verifier light flashed green. It always did. We hadn't had someone try to impersonate a senator in more than 20 years. Not at the Capitol in Denv, anyway.
She's fine. She'll be starting with Higgins, Scalino, and Knack next week. She's excited.
Halberstam smiled.
She really appreciated the leather case, Senator.
It was my pleasure. And a reminder to Halberstam that I rewarded families as well for their father's or mother's loyalty. Give her my best. I was among the first in the members' chamber behind the dais. It was a severe, long room with several consoles against one wall and two small oblong conference tables with straight-backed chairs around them.
How long will this be?
Asked Owen Ridings, the newly elected senator from the Piedmont. His long red hair was tied back in the rediscovered colonial fashion, except Owen was anything but colonial in outlook. Too long, Owen, I grinned. It's a simple technical bill, and most of the members understand it. The hearing was a markup session on legislation to streamline the functions of NASR, the NORAM Securities Registry. He groaned. With a nod, I slipped through the door to the main hearing room and took my place in the chairman's seat in the middle of the curved and raised wooden desk dais, real oak, and dating back more than a century. The hearing room was less than half full, and most of those that were there were either securities solicitors or their paralegal staffers. Owen followed me in and took his seat at the left end. I sat there for 4 minutes, until 10 o'clock sharp.
This committee will come to order,
The business at hand is consideration of S-127, legislation to provide technical improvements in the organization of the NORAM Securities Registry. I glanced around.
Mr. Chairman,
announced Senator Perez, sitting at the far left side of the dais.
I have an amendment at the desk.
The clerk will read the amendment, I began.
I ask consent that the reading be dispensed with, Mr. Chairman. Each senator has a hard copy and a link file.
So ordered.
This amendment,
Perez continued in her growling low voice,
is designed to clarify reporting requirements for significant shareholders. Under the current requirements, for example, trusts held by non-immediate family members are not considered under the control of a single entity, nor are irrevocable trusts to minors, even when the trustee has orders from a guardian who may also hold a significant block of such securities. This amendment requires reporting of such circumstances and makes failure to report such holdings a Class 1 administrative felony, the same as failure to report significant holdings under current law. A fuller description is on each.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.